Look at you all professional. You've been doing a lot of these, I can tell.
Yes, been plowing through them, which has been good, you know?
I know you like to plow through things.
You know it, especially from the back. Especially from the back.
This is What a Joke.
With Tom Papa and Fortune Feimster.
On Netflix is a joke radio.
When you first started doing drag, did the comedy part come later? Because, I mean, a big part of your show is basically stand-up.
Yeah, no, it kind of started, I was just filler, you know? I was either the new queen that came into the show and I would have to lip sync and do all that shit that I can't stand now. But I'm not good at it, so that's why I don't like it. Uh-huh. But when I see people do it well, it's pretty amazing. But I was kind of the filler. And then once they saw that I had a mouth, then I was stuck to talk while people were doing costume changes. So it mm-hmm. all kind of just happened. If you can imagine this on a Wednesday night at 1 a.m. in New Orleans doing a drag show, and these people are waiting for a show, and I'm the asshole that has to fill in the gaps. So drunk people were not fond of me, and that's kind of how my nastiness began. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
there's nothing worse.
It's defense. Yeah.
Yes.
It's survival.
Completely. Completely. I mean, 1 a.m. on a Wednesday. Like, what the hell? Like, who the fuck is out? Yeah. That's New Orleans.
I love it. And now you're selling out all over the world. It's
thank
great.
God.
Giant shows. It's
well,
so
you're not
cool.
You're not doing too shabby yourself, ma'am. Okay. Let's be real here. I've seen all those sold out dates. You know, we just do what you got to do. You just go. And they say, dance, monkey, dance. And I'm dancing as fast as I can, you know? You got to.
It was such a great platform for you, though, because you're so funny and you're unique. And also, you can sew like nobody's business.
Well, that helps. You know, I mean, I think that was, I mean, the show now, I look at it, Drag Race, and it's just a completely different show than when we did it. Because we were season 6, which is, what, 8 years? I mean, it's probably 8 years since we filmed. And what was crazy is that it was just a different setup then. And I was grateful that I had the opportunity when I did it. But you got to go in prepared. And in my day, the drag queens did sew. They did sing. They did act. They did, you know, they did everything. Now they're just little Instagram bitches that look pretty and they go, I want to win $100,000. I'm like, what content do you have? What substance do you have? You know?
Yeah.
But we live in a world of Kardashians. So, I mean, I guess that's how it is now, right? You know, it's that if you're pretty, you go far. But it's ugly people.
Ugly people gotta work.
Yes, bitch.
I'm tired.
Exactly.
Do you think it was Drag Race that opened people's minds so much to drag queens? Because now, like, people are all about drag.
I think with everything, it's good and bad. You know, it's great to have the exposure, but it's also kind of fucked up that people assume that what they see on Drag Race is all that drag is. And that's mm-hmm. unfortunate, too. So I think it's the good and the bad. You know, the fact that drag is being played in people's living rooms, I think it's amazing. You know, I've had grandmothers and a 13-year-old boy in heels come to my show, which mm-hmm. is just insane to me. But I go, how cute is that? You know, like if they can experience that or if they find it non-threatening, that's good. You know,
right.
I mean, I hope it continues to ride. I mean, they're putting out season after season over there. So I have no idea where we are. I don't know who half these bitches are. So I say, I'm glad I did it when I did it.
Yeah.
And it's been an amazing ride, you know?
Yeah. What parts of drag do people that aren't familiar with it, that they don't see that it goes beyond the shows?
Oh, well, it ain't glamorous at all. I mean, I like to keep show after show after show after show. I like to do at least 6 in a row and then go to another one. I don't want to have too much time in between. I don't need too much vacation time. You lose momentum. You lose, you know, you lose the fire in it. So I do a lot of shows back to back. And with that, you know, we're on a bus. You're schlepping from one city to the next. You finish the show. You're getting out of drag. You're loading the bus. You're going. Mm-hmm. And I also have to do a meet and greet every night. That's 150 to 200 people. So I do that before the show.
The meet and greet before the show.
Yeah, well, I do that mainly because I am a drag queen, so I won't be sweaty after the show. And also, they're not drunk yet, and they're still scared of me, which is good. So it speeds
smart.
It along. You know what I mean?
If not,
if you do it after the show with some drunk bitch, she's going to cry, tell you her fucking life story. She's going to discuss it. You're sweating. The pictures never look decent. So I figure you do that. And the other advantage, too, and I don't know if this works for you guys, but when I do that, then even if the whole show goes to shit, let's say there's 2,000 people and it's, you know, 1,500 suck. I know that those first 20 that I met, I know who's the drunk one. I know who's the happy couple. I know who has the boyfriend that's scared of me. I know, you know, so all of that works out to my advantage because they're usually the first 20 rows. So if anything, you've got them, at least the people you see. So
that's smart.
That kind of works out as well. You filter them out. You know, you find out what their problems, whose anniversary, who's this, who's that.
Yeah,
so if all else goes to shit, you've got them.
That's smart. I always put it. I always put it after because I figure after the show they'll be impressed with the show and that I'll be a bigger deal once the show is over.
No,
you're really making a lot of sense.
You're the same piece of shit before and after.
How long does it take you now to get into drag?
Oh, well, if you've seen me, it ain't no blending, so it's quick. It's literally just, I don't bother with that pretty shit. I just trace circles.
You're not doing a Trixie Mattel contour?
Oh, hell no. I can get ready in an hour, you know, okay. But when you're getting into the venue, I like about 2 hours because I got to set up everything and, you know, get the smells out of the room, wipe everything down.
You get the smells out of the room.
You know those dressing rooms ain't glamorous. You know.
That's hilarious.
So, yeah, you just got to kind of set everything up. So I can do 2 hours. For sure. I mean, I've had to do it in 45 minutes. You know, it just varies on the night. But 2 hours is nice because you're setting up the room and you're getting in the zone. I can check my phone. I can apply my lashes. I can have a little sip of wine. And, you know,
you do more than I do.
Well, I know.
I barely brush my hair.
But you've got it figured out. Had I thought of that, I sit and look at bitches like you and I go, damn, a flannel shirt and flat shoes.
Come on.
I mean, that's fucking talent. Yeah.
What's been your most memorable show?
I mean, God, really, the fact that I get to work is exciting. So I just say all of them. But I did Carnegie Hall, which was amazing to get to do. And Wembley Arena in the UK, which is 15,000 people, which
is crazy. Crazy, but that's so cool.
It's mind fucking, I must say. But you still got to do the show and just pretend like it's 10 people and don't lose your mind over it. You know, you can't play those mind games.
Right.
Yeah.
Wow, that's impressive.
You can't be faint of heart to go to your show.
No. And I think, but that's also the thing. It's I'm not allowed to do it on Twitter. You're not allowed to do it in videos. It's like if people are coming to see you, you're in the environment. That's what it is. So I've learned through social media that, you know, tweeting or having camera phones and all that kind of madness with no context can be really, really frustrating. And that's just what they run with. So I think we've lost context in the world thanks to social media. Mm-hmm. So I just try not to give them anything to bait off of, you know, I just let it ride. If you want to come see me be hateful, come see me be hateful. But it's a tricky line online, you know, it's a tricky way to go because we've seen people get canceled or get ruined, which is kind of fucked up. But if you know where it's coming from, it's funny to certain people. It's almost like you're punished for saying or thinking, but yet they'll say it all privately, which is what's so crazy about it, I find. You know, if it's not for you, if it's not for you, it's not for you, you know? Yeah. And I think a lot of people think that you have to be for everybody. And it's not. If you don't like it, you don't get it. It's fine. You know, that's there's somebody else for you to like. But gay people are the worst because the gays want to be liked by everybody. And I go, that's what you're doing wrong. You know what I mean? I don't care if they like me. But the gays want to be a role model. They want to be an entrepreneur. They want to be a fashion icon. Look here, faggot. Just tell jokes. Just tell jokes. So I get bothered by all of that. I just go, look, if you don't like it, move the fuck on. It's very simple. Yeah. You know?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And before we let you go, your podcast.
Yeah, I just started a podcast. Well, you know, it's that thing. My friend Brad Locally always said during COVID, he says, you either come out of this with a podcast or an OnlyFans. So I'm grateful that
I'm
had
on OnlyFans.
Can you imagine? Girl.
Just kidding.
Yeah, do it. I mean, everybody's doing it. So yeah, it was wild. The Starburns Audio had been up my ass for about 4 years saying, can you do one? Can you do one? And I just thought at that time you had to be in one place in one specific city doing it all the time. And I said, nah, I don't know if I can commit to it. And, you know, and that thing of like, oh shit, I got to talk for an hour. Like, what am I going to talk about? And then during COVID, you know, after those first 9 months, I was like, okay, maybe I should take them up on this offer. So it's been fun. It's a nice format and I don't have to get in drag for it. That's the best part. You know, I ain't got to shave. I'm sitting there, beard and hairy balls and all, just like talking smack.
I knew they were hairy.
You knew it.